Good afternoon. Couple of things before I start. There's a couple of slides later on that are like flashy imagery, so if that is a thing that you have an issue with, just bear that in mind. Second, everybody stand up. Because no one's done this yet today, so I get to be the guy who does this thing. Right, so sit down if this is your first Gurukha. Right, that's about half. Right, if you're sitting down, you have to high-five someone standing up. Alright. Alright, normally I would just stop there and make you all sit down, but I'm liking this, people standing up now. So sit down if it's your second. Third. Fourth. Fifth. Sixth. Seventh. Eighth. Nine. Ladies and gentlemen, we have our winners of Gurukha. Round of applause. Obviously the microphone, it's a cheap treat. You guys can sit down now. Everyone can just chill out. So invariably at the beginning of a conference talk like this, you've got questions. And the main one is who is this guy? I often have this question too. So I'm gonna help you out. Hey Siri, who is Andy Kroll?
I have no idea who this fine gentleman is, but I would not let him anywhere near a microphone.
So natural sounding. So I decided to do the one thing you should never do, which is Google yourself. So apparently Andy Kroll Nike is he's a recruiter in Portland. Andy Kroller is actually Anthony Kroller, who's a world champion boxer. Andy Kroll Glamorgan is a history professor at the University of South Wales, so my nearest rival. But if you write my name into Google and click I feel lucky, you get my site. I am the Andy Kroll from the internet. You're welcome. So that's me on the right in 1982 with hair. I'm no one special. I'm a working developer just like most of you. I call myself a consultant because it helps keep the day rate up. The only difference is that this year's organizers have ignored the good advice of the third best voice assistant in the world and given me a use of the microphone for the next half an hour. I do run a little opinionated newsletter once every fortnight. And I get this from my work. It's like when I'm reviewing a pull request and I go, actually, have you thought about doing it this way? I turn that into a less annoying version and then I ship that as a newsletter. I also lied about the only difference being the microphone. I'm also shit hot at Keynote. It's quite a personal talk, this one. There's not much code, so I apologize to the people who are going to review me poorly. More enough review. We are going to be getting into some serious life stuff. I hope you'll indulge me. This is Carl. I met him when I lived in Singapore. He was starting the Pivotal Labs office out there. He's now running the Seattle office. He's a huge part of me being able to do the work that I do today. He influenced my professional thinking, and gave me the opportunity to work with them and his team, and he helped get my first conference off the ground. He also pointed out the following conceit in a lightning talk, which I've completely stolen. So this is the number of hours in the average human life. About 10 years ago, he worked out it's also roughly the number of pixels on a fabulously old school monitor. I have a more modern comparison than this. There are roughly as many pixels on a standard size iPhone as there are hours in your life. So what does that look like? So here's a phone screen of hours. So that's sleep, straight away. This top bit disappearing, that is mostly learning to talk, walk, and wipe your own bum. I've got a note, it says to localize the talk. So when I said bum, you should hear the word ass, or butt, or in my case, booty. Sorry to the organisers of the last ever Garuko, I'm sure this is not how you expect it to go out. Like a British man saying words for bottom on the stage. Anyway, that's school, that's university if you go. I am roughly here. This red spot, that you can probably see even at the back, is this fine conference, whose logo I improved. This red spot is the week of no sleep I had on the floor of a hospital in the UK when my twins were born. Here you can see my daughter already plotting to take over the world, day three. These four dots are the years of Brighton Ruby, the conference I run on the south coast of the UK. It's in 3 weeks' time. I really shouldn't be messing around in New York. This block is the 20 work days it took me to upgrade a particularly gnarly Rails app from version 3 to 4. We are definitely in the era of there being plenty of legacy Rails apps around. That sentence is enough to make me feel old. And this little sliver is all 40 hours and 39 minutes of the Marvel Cinematic Universe. So, I've given this talk before, and the version of the slide I had here had 25% less hours on it when I first gave this talk. At this rate, it's going to eclipse the week I spend in the hospital with my kids, and it's not like there isn't another 2 hours coming next month. Or another 2 hours after that. Or, crumbles to dust. The idea that life is short is not a new idea. 2,000 years ago, Seneca, a Roman philosopher, wrote, "People are frugal in guarding their personal property, but as soon as it comes to squandering time, they are most wasteful of the one thing that is right to be stingy." So you're probably a little bit freaked out right now, particularly if you've seen any of the Marvel films more than once, as I have. It's not going to get any better for a bit, I'm sorry. Anyone recognize this? Show of hands. Interesting. My crowd are here. This is good. I was expecting it to be much less. So this is the login screen for an Amiga 500. I'm dating myself fairly specifically to 1989, when Commodore, a British computing company, dropped the price of this machine and bundled it with a brutally difficult Batman game. Now, as much as we can agree that Michael Keaton is the definitive on-screen Batman, that wasn't what grabbed my attention. Hand up if this means anything to you. Slightly less, but you are my people. Just so you know, Lucasfilm Games was an offshoot of Industrial Light and Magic. They were the special effects house that was created when they made Star Wars, basically. It became LucasArts, and they had these fabulous like point-and-click adventure games made by really small teams, and the personalities of the creative people writing those games really shine through. I spent days playing this, because this is before the internet, so I couldn't just go Google for how do I get past this puzzle. I had to sit there and like click on one of the things. You can even buy remastered versions of these on like on your phones or your PC. They really hold up. They're actually genuinely still worth playing. This one was my favorite. This is The Secret of Monkey Island. It came on 4 floppy disks. It had physical copy protection. You had to like spin the wheel to get the pirate head to look the same, then you had a special key. It had a real colorboard box that, as I recall, was about the size of a human chest. So what do you do with this enthusiasm for this marvelous game that you completely adore if you are a 15-year-old nerd? Let us take a trip back in time to a teenager's bedroom. Not like that. This is my first website. I managed to dig back into a CD-ROM in a cupboard in my house. It has table tags, it's got image hovers, I cut all the images out myself. It does look a bit strange, because it's best viewed 800 by 600 in IE4. I'll just reload it. The internet's really slow.
One number.
That is much better. It amazingly loads in modern Safari. This is the effort of quite a lonely 15-year-old boy. How can you tell it's the late 90s? Webbring. Webbring. Web ring. So web rings are what we did before social media. Sort of like when Reddit used to run on Steam. There's also some new GIFs, which is a feature that I feel like we've lost a little bit from our current web design. A bit of a shame. Sadly, this work of unalloyed genius burns too brightly for the internet to hold, and is lost forever. So, years pass. I get a degree, I get a blue chip corporate job, which I then lose. I get a girlfriend, which I manage to keep and marry, despite the Monkey Island fan site. I move to Singapore, I meet Carl, I change careers from big corporate to the websites I love building as a teenager. Working with small teams of great people, learning how to do engineering properly. Then came sort of, I think it was the startup era, Andy. I was roped into a travel startup by a good friend in Singapore. Like, we raised a bit of money. It was pretty easy to raise seed money at that point in Singapore. We even had a real business plan, which is somewhat unusual for a startup controversial. So we were doing like flash sales for luxury hotels. The tech was awesome. The team was lovely and hilarious. Like, I've got text files full of like funny stuff we said, reminiscing in Starbucks. We solved interesting problems. Like, we were one of the first companies to embrace responsive email. We had an iPhone app. We had like a cool admin interface so the family could like run the whole business without me having to like manage the database tables and stuff. We even had a few profitable months. But travel is brutal. If you can't make search engine marketing work, you are basically completely out of luck, and we cannot make that work. And that is also gone. When my wife and I returned to the UK after 6 years in Singapore, Impossify was winding up, and I decided I'd do some contracting for a bit. I felt like I'd learned a few things. I didn't want to be employed. I definitely didn't fancy the VC thing we'd just been through, and I was sick to death at travel websites. Which is how I ended up working full-time at Housetrip, a VC-funded travel startup. I think it's clear by this point I do not know what I am doing. It was a massively dysfunctional product environment. I joined a team of four people rebuilding MailChimp rather than just using MailChimp. They were terrified of the legacy code they managed to build up in the 4 years of like high growth and like mad push for features. There's a man sitting in the front row who now works at San Francisco, also used to work at Housetrip. It was quite funny to see him here. He will, speak to Carl if you want to find out what it's really like, because he was there before I was, and during the really mad years. The business tried to raise more cash, so throwing money on the Google bonfire to accelerate growth, but they're not running out, effectively. So 6 months into my employment there were layoffs. Lots of them. It was a shitty fortnight, frankly. More than half of engineering, like 80% of the product managers, 80% of the designers, like 30 to 40 people all gone from this company. After that, I like to call it the unfortunate event, something strange happened. Like, the remaining product team started to gel. There was lots of pairing, lots of teaching. Some of the madder elements of the leadership had also left. We worked sensible hours, we moved the product along. I really liked the shit work of refactoring a legacy app to make it perform and fast and make it work. I like changing the wheels on a moving car, provided like the people driving the car are nice people. We even keep like a legacy Slack around because everybody needs another Slack. I sort of describe this period of Housetrip as like crashing a plane into the runway. So like it's not like we completely missed the airport, but like, we didn't land the plane either. We all had to go down the slide. Just sort of nice. So, given that like houseflies have a better survival rate than my career, so I'm guessing that nobody else here has ever written a website that's gone away. I'm not alone. Basically, is what I'm saying. Nearly all of my code that I wrote is gone. I'm hardly the first person to have made disappearing websites or products. These are years of people's lives. We should pour one out for Google Reader, basically. There's even a marvelous Tumblr from a guy in the UK. It republishes the cheery shutdown notices of failed companies as the remnants are acquired by Facebook or Google. The sites are abandoned, the user's data is gone, the service that they loved is gone. Unless it does get acquired by Facebook. It's not all bad things that this is doing. So Tamagotchi, they're gone. T-shirts that show off how sweaty your underarms are, also gone. Those Budweiser adverts finally stopped being made. So what have we learned here? Like, you can't force it. Like, adding money doesn't guarantee longevity. Like, having good design and engineering doesn't even help. It's not even the things that we turn off or shut down. Like, we're constantly refreshing and re-architecting and redesigning. You know, we're putting things into services, and then we're taking the services and putting them back in the monolith. Like, our very work is often the destruction of earlier work that we've done. Like, links rot, code decays, and entropy wins. So if it's not about the end result, given like the shifting sands, like perhaps it's about the journey. Like, should I set out to learn from our industry about success? So I did. I have done a detailed analysis of every recruiter's email I've ever received. And I would like to share with you the scientifically derived average job in the tech industry. It's not even just the rank and file. Steve Jobs famously wanted to put a dent in the universe. Which sounds good, yeah, right? Making history. Marissa Mayer, the former CEO of Yahoo, former CEO of former company Yahoo. Like, being there on the weekend is a huge indicator of success. Mostly because these companies don't just happen. They happen because of really hard work. So work all the hours, got it? Jeff Bezos, founder of Amazon, a glorious legacy. This is Travis, until last year the CEO of Uber, a startup which can be best described as the Uber of sexual harassment. Oh, Jesus. These people are, in the nicest possible way, wildly foolish. Like, sacrifice your health by working on something as a point of virtue. Like, run a company with abject morals. You know, treat people poorly in the pursuit of some nebulous success. Like, it doesn't stop. I've been guilty of this in the past. Like, go big or go home, you know. Leave your mark on the world. Work incredibly long hours. Like, advice from successful people is survivorship bias. Like, the human brain is a story machine. It likes to add narrative where often there isn't any. People look like they know where they're going, but they don't. If they do think they know where they're going, they might be actively dangerous. I'm a guest in this country. So I'm just going to leave it to you to see if you can think of anybody who is completely certain of their own genius and a potential catastrophic liability. I can't think of anybody. Our Roman friend Seneca again. It is inevitable that life will not be just very short, but very miserable for those who acquire by great toil what they must keep by even greater toil. New preoccupations take the place of the old. Ambition excites only more ambition. They do not look for an end to their misery, but simply change the reason for it. So Seneca is not the only philosopher I'm going to introduce you to today. This is Alan Watts. He's a British philosopher who reinterpreted a lot of Eastern wisdom for the Western world in the late 60s and 70s. And because that's when he was a philosopher, there's loads of recordings of him. This is what he had to say about the journey.
Because music, as an art form, is essentially playful. We say you play the piano. You don't work the piano. Why? Music differs from, say, travel. When you travel, you are trying to get somewhere. In music, though, one doesn't make the end of a composition the point of the composition. If that were so, the best conductors would be those who played fastest. And there would be composers who wrote only finales. People go to a concert just to hear one crashing chord, because that's the end. Same way in dancing. You don't aim at a particular spot in the room. That's where you should arrive. The whole point of the dancing is the dance.
So I'm going to bring us back to this slide. What if this is all you've got left? This is a photo from December 2016, 18 months ago. You might deduce a particular family resemblance from the profile. This is another photo of me and my dad. It's the last photo of us together. He died 2 weeks after this was taken. He was 64. He worked hard his whole life. Long, multi-hour commutes into London, late nights. He'd recently remarried and was looking forward to his well-earned retirement. He was 64. In his eulogy, which he wrote, because he was always organised, he admitted that at lots of points in his life, he got his balance of work and life wrong. At his funeral, people told me they admired his kindness and the way that he quietly looked after everybody. They didn't mention his work at all. I'm not trying to panic you. I'm trying to give perspective. If you do want to leave a legacy, don't expect it to be the obvious. I guess my point here is the finale is the same for all of us, and it's not the journey we should focus on. There is one destination. That's why I love Alan Watts' metaphor for the dance. Like, your work, the code, is not going to be remembered. This should be freeing in all sorts of ways. The only truly profoundly extraordinary things that most of us experience will be things that we can all experience. Death, love, birth, friendship. If there's no certainty, and there isn't, you can still enjoy the movement. A psychologist might call this self-actualization. Like, I dive into the flow state of programming. I love taking apart software and putting it back together again, like improving things little by little. That's what flips my switch. Like, I love to lose myself in the problem solving. I love the dance of code. This is why I love Ruby. It's the feel of it. It fits me. Another famous philosopher said, "For me, the purpose of life is partly to have joy. Programmers often feel joy when they can concentrate on the creative side of programming." So Ruby is designed to make programmers happy. Ruby is specifically designed to get us into that delightful flow state. We can dance with Ruby. That joy in the movement, you know, momentum perhaps, can lead into all sorts of like dangerous behaviors in the tech industry. Like, my current gig is with a fabulous team of seven in my hometown. And the team of seven in Brighton, there's one living here in Manhattan. We also have two office dogs, so we are really good at coding. One of the best habits we have as a team is regular as clockwork, full team retro. It takes a couple of hours every couple of weeks. Every time the meeting comes around, I think, bloody hell, again? We just had this meeting. And then every time we have the meeting, we surface problems, solve issues, and understand each other better. Now, there's a variety of behaviors that allow this to happen in our company. There's an openness, you know, a respect for each other. But for me, it's the process of deliberate self-reflection that really shines through. It helps get my head out of the weeds, at least. And my friend Sarah is right about loads of things. Whilst our code may not last forever, and no one is going to build a statue of you, life is too short to be building useless things. The point of this reflection is to work out the movement you enjoy. This is Kevin Bacon in Footloose. Yes, everyone on board? The happiest people I know found a way to maximize their day-to-day joy. I don't hustle yourself to death in search of success or romanticize overexertion. Coffee is not a food group. We have to avoid blurring the lines between, you know, commitment and engagement. But thinking of things in terms of a journey means you're clinging to a destination or trying to get there as fast as possible. But you don't even know what it's going to be like when you get there. And you don't even know if you'll like it. The coverage book, like our smallness and profitability, means that we've gone to like a 4-day week, which is awesome. That's what we've chosen to do with the success that we have. Like getting a day back from work, which we do something else with. Hang out with our kids, ride a bike, learn a new programming language, but like whatever you want to do, that's a good use of success. I have one final piece of thought for you from one of the 1980s greatest minds.
Yep. I said it before and I'll say it again. Life moves pretty fast. You don't stop and look around once in a while, you could miss it.
I know everyone's disappointed. Oh, yeah. Ferris Bueller was right. Like, take care of your mental health so you can take care of others. Step away from your email. Go for a walk. It's not news to take care of yourself. Right? I'm probably the first person to go, take care of yourself, is it? But this is your periodic reminder. This should be no surprise to those of you who've been paying attention to the human thread that's woven through this talk. Dancing on your own can be fun. Ask my kitchen. Dancing with others is a basic human joy. Like, all of the things I remember from my career are people. I don't remember the code I wrote. I don't remember great database migrations of the past. That's why I'm here in this room giving this talk. Ruby is its people. The core team, like all of the open source contributors, like the organizers of events like this, like everyone who suffered through an afternoon pairing with me, the writers of blog posts and non-snarky Stack Overflow comments, all of these people indulging in a shared passion for what is a, frankly, pretty abstract notion. The only dents in the universe are in those people. Let them be good dents. Now, these are the marvelous people I've worked with over the years. Like, I'm close with some of them still, some of them I lost touch with. But they make up a huge proportion of my laughter and basically taught me all the things I think I know. Their company has made my life better, and I hope that's true in the opposite direction. It's a quote from a friend of mine, Saron. I cannot stress this sentiment enough, and it's true if you're not the manager as well. This is my all-encompassing theory of humanity. I told you we were going here. We are all scared and clueless and at the mercy of our lizard brains. Food, stuff, your choice of text editor. How much you are in control of your inner stroppy toddler is how much of a pain you are to be around on any particular day. And if you need help trying to control that inner toddler, just remember that everyone else is a toddler too. The same way you might humor a four-year-old, you can apply to your coworkers. Easy. You cannot peer into people's minds. You can ask how they're feeling. They may tell you. They may not. You cannot tell people what shit people have got going on in their lives unless they choose to reveal it to you. Half the time, I don't know how I feel. Or even why I feel like it. How are other people supposed to know? We crave certainty, but nobody has it. There is a dangerous trend in our industry to demand fealty to a dream or loyalty to a company. You know, from shitty salaries in exchange for options, which are worth nothing more, typically, to like rare opportunity job descriptions. Like, a group of people don't know what they're doing any more than one person does. I've been on both sides of redundancies, like the ones I talked about earlier. The people involved behave as best they can, but the company doesn't care. The company just wants to survive. So don't be loyal to the company, be loyal to the people inside them. This is Sarah. She works at the New York Times now and gave an awesome talk at Wired Ruby a couple years ago. We've begun to talk a lot about empathy as a community, which is great. And when confronted with something obviously awful, I like to think we'd all help. But it does take more than that. This is Derek Sivers, a friend of mine who's in New Zealand. Like, he made the point that it's what you do that counts, not what you say you want to do. Kindness is underrated but has outsized impact. Kind people are more fun to work with. There's no such thing as right. There's only doing right by other people and feeling good about it. It's very easy to take out your shitty mood on the people around you. It's easy to think the other person is an idiot. It's very easy to communicate poorly. There is a constant battle to be the best version of you. And one more thing. There is no need to be a dick on the internet. And if you're a dick on the internet, please learn to apologize properly. That's all I have to say about that. This is Kylie. She was thanked in an earlier presentation as well. I take this opportunity before I give up the stage to ask, what are you doing with your privilege? Are you helping? Like, it doesn't need to be starting an apprenticeship, but if you want to, that's your thing, you can do it. It doesn't need to be a big gesture. It can be as simple as just trying to improve the culture where you work, or it can be as difficult as trying to improve the culture where you work. I'm a work in progress. I've only got my experiences for you and the smart things said by other people. I don't have all the answers. We're all a work in progress, really. I've shipped a lot of software, not much of it is still running, but I've laughed hard, and I've been pulled along by marvelous people, and I've tried to pull others along with me. What we often think is the work is not the work at all. Looking for the certainty in your code, the software you write, or the things that you build, can distract you from the enjoyment of the dance. And in the midst of all the technology and the code and the bustle of the everyday, don't lose sight of your own happiness and the real legacy you leave, the legacy of the people that you work with. And with that, I'll leave you, as I've got a bunch of pixel hours to film with life and other people. Thank you very much.